La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah.
Muhammadun Rasulullah. Muhammadun Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillahi wa kafa. Wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina astafa. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. I was thinking about what topic to talk about, and it seems almost certain that, I mean, with being so close to Ramadan, there's really nothing else to talk about. Because there's no doubt that for the people who are making an effort to progress towards the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the month that's about to come upon us is like an Eid. It's like a celebration. Because the mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they open up to such an extreme degree. And not only that, I mean, that would be just, in and of itself would be an incredible event. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us by restricting the movement of the shayateen. And that itself would be an incredible event. But then you take it one step further, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned us in that particular month to do certain ibadat that crush our nafs. So those three things together provide the most perfect environment for progression towards one's Lord. I mean, essentially there are three factors that allow you to progress towards Allah. One, Allah's mercy. Two, your effort. And three, the thing that hurts you is the most is distraction from shaitan. So here you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy revealing itself in ways that it just doesn't expose itself in other months. You have ibadat assigned to us, which force us to make certain efforts that we would never make in other months. And the number one hindrance to our progress, shaitan, and his shayateen, they're tied up, and they're restricted in their movement. Those three things together provide such an incredible field for planting that the person who takes advantage of every moment in that month, they reap enormous benefits. So basically, you know, a few days before Ramadan, it just doesn't make any sense to talk about anything else except for Ramadan. If you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he rarely, I mean, in the hadith, if you read through the different hadith, you'll never find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cursing anybody. He was a rahmatul lil alameen. It's very, very rare to find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cursing a group of people or cursing a tribe or cursing some action. But for example, there was an occasion when the Prophet ﷺ was forced to miss five prayers in a row during a particular battle. And because the fighting was so intense during that battle, he had to miss four or five prayers, and then he had to make them all up in the evening. And he cursed the people who forced him to do that. That was one of the rare occasions where Prophet ﷺ actually cursed. And not them in and of themselves, but he cursed the fact that they had forced him to miss the prayer. On another occasion, the Prophet ﷺ was climbing the minbar, and as he was climbing the minbar, with every step he said the word Ameen. When the Sahaba turned to him and asked, Ya Rasulullah, why did you say Ameen as you climbed each step? The Prophet ﷺ then related three du'a by the angel Jibra'il. Each of those du'a established a very important principle and actually resulted in a curse. For example, one of the du'a, the angel Jibra'il made a du'a, may Allah curse be the person who finds his parents in old age and he doesn't attain Jannah. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ameen. Another du'a, cursed be the person who attains the month of Ramadan and does not attain forgiveness. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Ameen. And I'm just roughly translating this hadith to just present a principle. And here, I mean, this is actually a curse. And the Prophet ﷺ is saying, Ameen. Now look who's making the du'a. It's the angel Jibra'il. The angels don't make a du'a except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them to make it. They don't come up with their own dua. It has to be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to go and make that dua. So here you essentially have the dua of Allah through the angel Jibreel. And then on top of that, you have the best of creation, the one whose heart Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Qur'an upon, the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his mahbub, and he's the one who's saying, Ameen. What greater being in this world, or what greater human being could there be to say Ameen to this dua? And the reason is, I mean, why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam curse someone who didn't attain forgiveness in the month of Ramadan? Why? What would be the purpose? What would be the reason behind it? And if you read the different sharh of this hadith, you'll see that the reason is because it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy in the month of Ramadan is so zahir. It's so abundant, it's so prevalent, it's so encompassing, it's so forceful and powerful that you'd have to be a complete fool to not be able to earn the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this month and even forgiveness. I mean, even the smallest degree of effort in this month is rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so extremely that you have to be the biggest fool on the planet to not be able to take advantage of this month. I mean, you'd have to purposely basically ignore the month, purposely not say Allah's name during the whole month, purposely not do a single act of ibadah during the month, and then perhaps you would fall out of the extreme showers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings that occur during this month. They're so severe and so all-encompassing that there's no way to avoid them. Just stepping foot in the masjid, just saying subhanAllah, just saying Allah, just saying bismillah, just saying inshaAllah, hearing the Qur'an, even making an attempt to fast, increasing your prayers, all of these deeds, they result in even more of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showering upon you. Anyway, for us, this month is extremely special. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins to shower these blessings, there is a general barakah that bestows the whole ummah. And then there are those who learn to focus the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their heart. And that's essentially what our training is. Every act that you do is a magnet towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Every good deed that you do, the time that you spend in the masjid, the Qur'an that you read, the sadaqah that you give, the time that you share with one another, the knowledge that you learn, these things act as magnets. And they act as magnets to draw the barakah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to your heart. That's the essential benefit. Now during the month of Ramadan, yes, there's an enormous degree of barakah. But there are people who know more and who take more advantage of this month. And they attract even more of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to their heart. And that's essentially our goal. That we focus on attracting as much as we can on bringing as many blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as we can upon our heart, as making our heart as munawwar as possible. And so the way we do that is with it, by carefully taking advantage of this month. Now anybody who has a fixed asset or a fixed amount of principal and they want to invest it, they think very, very carefully. Okay, I have $10,000, I could open a business on Divan, or I can go and buy stocks. And if I buy stocks, I'm going to spend 2 or 3 months researching which ones to buy. I'm going to watch it daily. And I'm going to be very careful about when I buy and when I sell. And I'm going to have very careful timelines of what I intend to do, how much I intend to earn. I mean, that's because that's your principle in this world. And you have a goal of maximizing your profit off your principle. Well, for the Muslim during the month of Ramadan, his principle is his time. All of us have 30 days or 29 days in which we have a free rein to draw as much of the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as possible in our lives. How will we invest that principle? That's the next question that remains. And it would be so foolish and so unfortunate if we just randomly entered this month not knowing the value of it and not investing our principle properly, because you won't maximize your return. You have to maximize your return in this month. This is your opportunity. So the way we do it is by planning very, very carefully. Planning which masjid. Know from now. Much beforehand you should know which masjid are you going to pray in. It's not that one day you're going to go meet your friends in this masjid, and the next day you're going to go to this masjid, and the third day you're going to go to that masjid. That's a game. You make a mess out of things. You end up getting late to the prayer. You end up not hearing the whole Quran because one imam is leading at one masjid and the other imam is leading at a different place in the Quran. You end up, you know, driving far away one day and driving close the next day, and it just becomes a game. Pick one consistent masjid that you're going to go to and stay there regularly and make sure that you regularly attend the recitation of that imam. Similarly, make sure that you get up for suhoor. Number one, it's an incredible sunnah. It's a sunnah of the Prophet. Even if it's just a sip of water, get up for the suhoor. But even more importantly, as soon as you get up, the first thing you do is you make your wudu. When you make your wudu, have the intention that you're being purified. Wudu purifies you. If you have the intention that you're being purified, it would even act as a greater source of purification. But beyond that, as soon as you make the wudu, make sure you make all the proper du'at for the wudu. What are the du'as after wudu that you're supposed to make? Use those to your advantage. Use every moment to your advantage. Use every action to your advantage. And then pray 2 rak'ah tahajjud. No matter what you do, pray 2 rak'ah tahajjud. I guarantee you that on the Day of Judgment, you'll forget the hunger that you would have had if you ate one less piece of bread at suhoor, but you'll remember for eternity the blessings and the rewards that you received for just those 2 rak'ah in tahajjud. There's no doubt about it. So every single action should be planned. We should have a very, very detailed plan that I'm going to wake up at this time. I'm going to read 10 subhanallahs. I'm going to read 10 times salawat on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then I'm going to I'm going to pray my tahajjud, and then I'm going to eat. And after I eat, I'm going to read a page of Quran, and then I'm going to go to the masjid, and I'm going to pray fajr in the masjid, and etc., etc., ila akhiri. You should have a complete, detailed plan. So we have to be very, very careful in the way we use this time, and we should have a very well thought out way we're going to invest this time, so that we can maximize our return. The other thing to realize is that we may not be able to hit the mark on the plan. Some days you may not be able to do everything that you did, but you have to have a goal. If there's no goal, you'll never reach anything. So your plan is your goal. And then inshallah, over time, each of those days will begin to reveal themselves and the reality of themselves, and your plan that you made will become easier and easier and easier as the days progress, as your nafs continues to get crushed by the fasting during the day and the praying at night, and as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy continues to reveal itself, and as the sins that Shaytan asked you or hinted to you to do outside of the month of Ramadan become wiped away from your heart, then you'll begin to experience a great degree of purity. But we have to take advantage of this month. You have to take advantage of this month in such a way that after the month ends, it lasts with you. For 2 to 3 months after Ramadan, we should continue to feel the blessings of Ramadan. And how unfortunate it is that we feel the blessings of Ramadan on the 28th or 29th of Ramadan because we weren't prepared, and we were very random, and then the day Ramadan ends, we return back to our despicable states. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to take advantage of this month, to invest our wealth during this month properly, and to attain maximum blessings from this month. Wa akhira da'wana, alhamdulillah, wa akhira da'wana.